welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, my name is Jordan. I am a Southern California-based bridal hairstylist, and today we are doing a much-needed updated bridal hairstylist Q&A. I get asked everything from hair to business to social media to wedding stuff on Instagram and TikTok, so I feel the best way to get all of those answers out for you guys is right here in one long-form video. That way we can get down into the nitty-gritty, so without further ado, let's dive into it. I am going to be reading all of these questions off of my phone, so I do apologize. I'll be looking down quite a bit because this question list is long and I'm going to try to get through all of them. First question that I get asked the absolute most, and I feel like it's pretty important for you to all know, is how I got into hairstyling. I started doing hair way back 9 years ago. When I was 16, I started during high school. There was a program that was offered and it was only $200 for the entire program, which I highly doubt you'll find that anywhere nowadays. It wasn't the best education, but in the end I got my license and that's all that matters. Sure, I went to beauty school and then I went to high school and I graduated both and eventually got my cosmetology license, began hairstyling at Great Clips, which was fine. Good dive into the industry, not the best, but I learned a few things very quickly. I got really good at cuts because they don't offer coloring, and then I moved into a full service salon where they did full service coloring and color corrections, and I just got stuck with color corrections, which weren't fun for me. So I moved to California because that's just where life took me with my ex-husband. And once I got out here, there were a lot of events and girls needed hairstyling. And I just did it on the side for free, for fun. It was just fun for me. And that's how I stumbled upon this industry. Back where I was from, it was a small town in Washington State. There just wasn't big weddings. Like, they were backyard weddings and friends would just do your hair. It wasn't like a big thing where you hire people. So out here in California, where it's like real big fancy weddings, I was just amazed and in awe, and that's how I learned that I wanted to be a bridal hairstylist. So basically, I just started chasing this passion of mine the second that I knew I wanted to do it. I didn't know how. Everything about my business I built from the ground up, from probably Google and just trial and error. So yeah, it's been the best industry ever and I love it so much, and I'm sure so many of you would too if you're watching this. How many weddings do you do a year? Honestly, I haven't counted how many I have on my calendar for this year now that it's September of 2023. I'm not too sure, but I know that I took significantly less. The last 2 years, however, each year I did 125 weddings, which is psychotic. I don't recommend it. My body hurt, but I, for some reason, was on this hustle era and had goals to reach. And once I reached them and reassessed, I was like, okay, that was insane. I gave up every weekend. I had no social life. My body physically hurt. It was just too much. So I definitely wouldn't recommend 125, but this year I feel like I've cut it down to definitely around the 60 or 70 range. So I've cut it down quite a bit. Do brides ever invite you to weddings? They actually do. Actually, oh my gosh. Okay, believe it or not, before 2020, I had only been to my mom's wedding and my aunt's wedding. So I had never been to like a big real wedding because, like I said, back home, they're all backyard potluck weddings, which is totally fine, always so fun. But out here, it just seemed like a whole different vibe as a guest. Like, it's actually a big party and celebration. And I went to do a bride's wedding in 2020, which I know most weddings were canceled. I don't know what this time was, but for some reason, they were approved to have their wedding at this hotel, and it was amazing. I walked in, met them that morning, and the groom was just chatting with me, and he's like, wait, so I bet you go to weddings all the time. And I was like, actually, no, I haven't ever really been to one. And he was like, oh, you have to stay. So he told me, he's like, have someone bring you a dress. And he told my bride, and he was just like, you're staying. And they were the sweetest couple ever. I love them so much. I felt like I was just being brought into the family and was adopted for the day. We danced all day at night and we just laughed and we did so many memories. She actually ended up having to write her vows on a card that I had given her for something. And it was a great day. And I do still have many brides that invite me to their weddings, and it's always always a good time. But I will say, I do turn down quite a bit of invites just because I have weddings the next day and priorities for those brides. I just don't want to be too exhausted and burnt out. How far out do you book? I used to book 9 months out. I tried that and I just switched it back to just booking 1 year out. So I'm liking that. I liked having more freedom over my schedule with the 9 month policy, but now that I'm back to my 1 year, I realize why I loved it so much. And it is kind of nice to, like, I feel like you do get more room for your personal life. Just be a little more mindful of holidays and stuff. It works a lot better for me knowing that far in advance. I just feel like I got so acclimated with this lifestyle and scheduling now that I've been doing it for 9 years. So I kind of like just doing the 1 year advance booking policy, and it's worked for me. Do brides feed you while you're there working? That is a great question. That is hit or miss. I personally always come really full, really hydrated, really caffeinated. I bring everything I need. I'll bring jerky in my purse, protein bars, just other quick, like, dry snacks that I can have. Uncrustables, I know not the healthiest, but great to keep in your car for emergency long drives or something. But not all brides feed us when we're there working. I have most of my brides that offer water and food and snacks, and they're so generous. Most of the time, if they do offer, I turn it down just because, like I said, I come pretty prepared. Sometimes I'll take them up on it, depending on how I'm feeling, but not everybody does. And yeah. Do you leave right after styling? Most of the time. Most of the time I'm done styling. They're starting photos. They don't need me there anymore. Sometimes I'll stay and just get, like, a couple quick little behind the scenes of the girls taking photos or in their dresses. But other than that, I'm typically just, I style, I do quick touch-ups at the end, and then I head home. The only exception is if they're doing a second style or if they're doing, like, touch-ups for a long period of time, which not everybody does, but some girls do. It's just all based on their preferences and if they added on to their contract prior. What is the basic beginner kit and price list you'd recommend for someone just starting this career? Never had this question before because honestly, the kit is up to you. If you're asking for beauty school, I would just do basic everything. Ask your instructors or your school what they would recommend because they probably have requirements. But if you're talking for, like, diving in, taking clients, what you put in your kit is up to you. It's up to you to try all of the products, make sure they work good. And what products you choose is, like I said, up to you. So the price can range depending on the product line that you pick and everything that you choose to. I would say my kit probably cost me a couple hundred, absolutely, because of, like, high quality curling irons. It's a good quality bag. But other than that, hair products themselves aren't that expensive. It's just expensive to keep refilling them because we go through them so often. But the kit itself, it typically isn't very expensive. One thing you wish brides knew on the wedding day, hair related or not? I wish they knew more about the timeline. I feel like they get very overwhelmed and very confused about it, but it's pretty simple. I always recommend hair after makeup for the bride. Doesn't matter for the bridesmaids to touch them up, but I feel like having the bride go makeup and then hair, and then I can style, like, one more girl for hair after, and then they all go out. It's great. I typically recommend for timelines, it go bridesmaids and then bride goes with makeup and then bride goes to hair and then moms and then touch-ups. So that's, like, the flow of the day I would suggest typically. If they are flower girls, I always recommend squeezing them in at the end just because their hair is so fine and falls out so quickly. But I feel like most of the time it's pretty straightforward and simple, but it's just confusing for them. The time is typically based off of the photographer, and then we work backwards off of what time you have to be ready. So I think that would be my number one thing. I don't know, if something else comes up, I'll let you know. Best volume spray and products. I feel like I have a lot of favorite volume sprays. Today I actually used the Tresemme volume spray, and I don't know what took me so long to use it because I've had it for so long. And it's so good. It smells amazing. My hair literally feels really voluminous, and it's a fraction of the price of the higher end ones. But other than that, what I keep in my kit for wedding days, I love the Airy Texture Spray from Authentic Beauty Concept. And then I love adding Puff Me Volume other than that, a full list of favorite products I don't share exclusively with the public just because it changes constantly, and I keep that for all of my students in my Bridal Biz 101 course just because I list them all out for them and I give full product education and knowledge on it. I feel like it's really important, any product you're using, that you are educating on it as well. If you are interested in that full kit list, as well as a million other in-depth education topics in the bridal realm, check out my course page on styledbyjordan.com. How do you communicate with clients who are asking for styles out of your specialty? I feel like if it's on the wedding day and they show me a picture of something that I don't typically do, I feel like I have a wide range of styles that I can do. I've learned the soft bridal styles, I've learned the boho styles, I've learned the sleek, I've learned cornrows and intricate braiding. So I feel like I am very grateful to cover a good amount of styles. I obviously have my preference of what I do like to do and what I don't like to do. So if there's something that I just don't think fits their hair or isn't the vibe for the day, I'll kind of ask them a couple questions to navigate them towards a different style. But if they want to wear it, ultimately, if I can do it, they're the one wearing it and paying for it. I do my best to get them to that style that they want. If it's out of my specialty and there is another artist that can do it, that is there, I would say do that, but I haven't ever had that happen personally. What camera do you use for your content? My iPhone. Literally 99.9% of my content is this iPhone, and I don't even know which iPhone it is. I will leave the details down below, that way you guys can know, but I want to say it's like the 11 or 12. It's just one of the iPhones. I want to say it's just the settings of my iPhone. I learned them all off of TikTok. They are amazing. Just TikTok it. If I do find it, I'll be sure to link that with my phone stuff below in the description as well. I always use my back camera. I always wipe my lens off before I use it, and then I use a tripod too. I'll grab it for you guys. This is the tripod that I use. It's my tried and true. It's from Amazon. I have a million of them, not a million, maybe three, but I like to keep one in my hair bag, in my car, and in my apartment. That way I just have one handy at all times. It comes with a remote. I never use the remote. I just slide it up and turn it sideways, and then I can just put my phone right on there, and that's how I record everything. When it's like a standing moving video, I just hold it in my hand. I don't use a gimbal or anything like that. No fancy editing. I don't really love filters or anything like that. So that's all I have for you. It's my iPhone, and that tripod is what I use when it's just standing there. When it comes to really, really high quality stuff, I use my Sony camera. I love it, but I very rarely use it. I'm using it for you guys right now because I'm using my phone for the questions. And I use it sometimes for just fun artistic videos, but ultimately it's too bulky, it's too expensive to lug around, it's too heavy, like it's just too much. And the iPhone does such a good job, and it's so quick and easy, and yeah, so I just use my phone. How long do you feel it took for you to be successful in your work? Honestly, I feel like this industry is, it seems oversaturated, but it's not. It is massive, and there's room for everyone at the top. So I feel like it happened really quickly. My following grew fairly quickly. I feel like the demand grew for services very quickly. I started my Instagram account in 2018. I looked it up yesterday because I had a one-on-one lesson with a student, and she was curious how long it took my account to get to where it is. So from 2018 to now, I have 52,000 followers on Instagram, and I feel like that's solely from posting consistently. So I don't feel like in 5 years, I don't feel like that's that long. 5 years is pretty short. So a lot can happen in such a short time if you just stick to it. I was very consistent with a lot of stuff, which we're gonna get into in the next couple questions. How important is networking? Networking is genuinely the most important thing. I know nowadays, like, everything is digital, but it is so important to still have those true, meaningful connections with people in your industry because, for example, what if something happens to you and you end up in the hospital and you need a hairstylist to cover for you and you don't know any bridal hairstylists, well, now you have no one to cover for you. You have to refund and really disappoint your clients. And their wedding days are really, really stressful now, all because you couldn't help them out a little bit just by networking. And I feel like that's really our job, to stay relevant in the industry and to create those connections with everyone, because at the end of the day, we're just all helping each other get to the top and we all have the same passion. And honestly, I know in other areas, the industry is not the same, but I feel like in San Diego, I have the closest tight-knit group of girls here that do hair and makeup, and we are all just cheering each other on. So I feel like networking at the end of the day is just more friends and more success for everyone. Any way of being successful in the industry without involving marketing on socials. If you have a really big personal network where you actually physically meet with people and they know you so well and you know millions and hundreds of people, yeah. But if not, no, I don't see how you could be without social media. That's the only reason I feel like I have been successful, because if I hadn't, I'm not from California, nobody would know my name. How would anyone ever find me? I can't just go out and introduce myself and show them what I do every day. So that's the perk of social media, and it can be overwhelming and stressful, and that's when it's great to outsource. So I am passionate about social media and I feel it's the number one reason for my success. How to make fine hair look thicker. Texture products such as texturizing spray that I recommended earlier, or texture powder, and if all else fails, hair extensions. I love hair extensions. I have my own little left and myself. Whether you do clip-in or the invisible bead, they're great. I feel like they're just a little mood booster if you can't get that natural full look that you are looking for with products alone. I will be sure to link a few of my favorite extensions and those recommended texture products down in the description as well. Advice for bridal stylists just starting out. I said this in my last Q&A a whole year ago that I rewatched just to reminisce, and I typed my answer out last night before I even rewatched that, and my answer was exactly the same. And that answer is just start now. Start where you are. You don't have to research the industry too much. Just start with what you have, start doing hair, start styling, start creating, start playing, taking pictures, posting pictures, and just being creative, because at the end of the day, that's what this industry is all about. You can start connecting with other creatives on Instagram and just introducing yourself and just getting inspired and just dipping your toes in the water in the bridal world. It's never too early, it's never too late. The time is now. The only way to ultimately figure this industry out is just by starting. There isn't a one size fits all, and it doesn't happen overnight. Like I said, I've been doing hair for 9 years and just started to see the growth over the last 4 or 5. And I just quit my part-time job only 2 years ago. 2 years ago, I was still working at a coffee shop as a barista outside of a community center. So start now. That way you can thank yourself down the line and be like, I'm so glad I started when I did, because had I not started when I did, I would not be as far along as I am today. Any tips for filming on site as a stylist? Honestly, I feel like it's all confidence. It's really nerve-wracking. I know, I get it. But I feel like it's 2023. People see it all the time. There are girls, tube girls out there dancing, and we're just pulling our kid out of our car. It's not embarrassing. There's nothing weird. We're just creating content for people to enjoy, and think of it as your personal own little TV show. It's so much fun, and I always get so excited when I am at the end of my editing process and I get to look at all of the content of my day, and it just makes me so much more proud and excited that this is my life and my job. So I feel like just prop your tripod up, because it just makes your clients that more excited for your video of their wedding day. That's all of the questions that I have for today's video. Thank you all so much for watching. And if you have any questions, feel free to always comment below or reach out to me on Instagram or TikTok. And I will see you guys in the next